like the emissivity.
Time for which we see emission, remember?
and with some light addition in there. So we consider a magnetic field. And then we derive the definition of motion. So we know that we have like this, an electron gyrates. And we call this angle the angle of the velocity with the magnetic field. And that doing this changes the direction of the velocity. So suffers an acceleration. And every time it radiates, and this is the radiation we see. And that's what we call synchrotron. And the power, now I average over all possible pitch angle, just for simplicity. The power is 4/3. The Thomson. The rate in a number of scattering of photons, magnetic photons by the electron. It's just like this. Gamma square, beta square, where beta is the velocity divided by the speed of light, and gamma is the velocity. Time is radiating and somewhere here, let's say. Then we have very low magnetic field. The cooling time is much longer, and of the order of 250 million years. So if I see, if I look in the sky, it's very likely that I see those lobes because they're persistent.
Gamma equal 10 to the 3. So again, I'm considering
power is 2.8 × 10^15 Hertz for a magnetic field of 10^3 and a gamma of 10^3. And so where my energy is being pushed, so from radio and being pushed up to, do you know which band is it, more or less? It's higher or lower than optical?
Higher than optical.
Lower? Higher. It's ultraviolet. I think I would say that optical is 10^14. It's very, very small in the optical band. But this is slightly higher. UV. So the same electron, but relativistic in the same magnetic field, emits in UV.
Yeah. I'm sorry if I missed some parts of your explanation before, but if you have sort a lot of electrons spiraling in the magnetic field of these blocks, where are the protons? I mean, do you have a net charge in the box, or this electron comes from the ions present?
Plasma is always neutral, otherwise you have currents and then neutralize.
Okay.
So you
have. So the electrons are from the plasma, local plasma, or come from the accretion disorder?
Okay, so I didn't explain this, but so for the jets, we don't know exactly where the electrons and the protons and everything is accelerated, but we think in shocks. And in the jets, and this, okay, so we don't know, but we think it's matter coming from the vicinity of the black hole. From the lobes, it may be instead local material that is shock accelerated. So we will see that for the gamma ray burst, we will see in detail where the accelerated material comes from. And we also saw that this power for the protons is 1 million times lower, so we are not considering synchrotron emission from protons, but only from electrons. And then finally,
I didn't get that. For protons, what change?
Okay. So in so we show that this is the cross section for Thomson scattering. It contains the mass of the electron or the charge that is accelerated at the denominator square. And so for the protons, this is it is much smaller. 1,800 square times smaller. Okay. And then the last thing that we did was to derive the spectrum from a single electron. And we already saw it. So this is removed the 1/3. This we will see. This is important also for the following. Move to the 1/3. Okay. So precisely the peak for this is for electron with a certain gamma. And also, let's say, for a certain theta, which angle? This time we are more precise. So the peak is at the frequency, which is 3/2 μs, same theta. So it's the one we derived with a numerical factor. And the peak is at But we will also always say, okay, B is that noise, the one that we derive. That is going to be the size of the system, the peak. And here you have an exponential cutoff. So it's mu divided by mu c to the 1/2. And e to the minus mu divided by mu c. So this is always log of, for instance, the power, and this is log of frequency. So it increases as a power and decreases exponentially afterwards. Okay. Instead, we saw that for beta much less than 1, we have a line, emission of a line, which is emitted at a normal frequency. And we call it type, so from line. And from the value of this line, we can derive directly the magnetic field strength. Okay, so this is all we did. And now instead of one electron, we take a distribution and we see the spectrum of distribution of electrons. This is what we actually see generally, not the emission of one particular electron.
Okay? So, this is the way as astrophysicists get the magnetic field in galaxies or something? Using this line, this cyclotron line, or?
I think it's been done for not for galaxies, which usually is usually it's always a distribution of electrons, so here in the reverse, in the cluster of galaxies. The line, I think, has been seen, or tend to be seen in neutron stars.
Why? If neutron star doesn't have very energetic electrons, because this is for non-relativistic electrons.
Yes.
And neutron stars are non-relativistic electrons.
Okay, so intensity in outburst or not, actually it's a thermal emission from the graphene neutron star. In general it's thermal and it's the body from the cluster when in the PS. But if you want next time I can do some examples of cyclotron 1. Okay. I keep this because we use it. Okay. Which distribution we said we would take always for non-thermal electrons? Remember we said gamma to the minus. But we have always used J. Remember J? So I will use J. Okay, so that we always use the same. So I will use J. So the emissivity at a given frequency.
Elena, why do you put up a dot above the letter?
Oh, just for J.
Ah, it's because of the dot of the J.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
What? I don't. It's like I, J. So the emissivity at a certain frequency. And, okay. And consider electrons. Gamma, that's this expression, right? direction of the velocity with respect to my magnetic field. So usually, actually, we put the integral in the dU. So you, for instance, you write the same thing this way. So J. So the emission between mu and nu plus in mu is only given by electron with gamma, between gamma and gamma plus the gamma linked to mu. Just the total power and gamma times the gamma divided by 4 pi. So you understand that this is comes to the power of minus gamma, minus t. Okay. That was big, but you don't have to know it. So we have the emission coefficient, and this is where optical steam source. What is the intensity? Specific intensity for an optically thin source, so if I have the emission coefficient. My source has the size R, for instance. Okay, we have done it many times, right? So now I want to plot intensity for an optically thin source, and it is in perturbation. I have the emission coefficient, we derive it. What is the intensity when tau is much tau nu and the frequency which tau nu much less than 1? I have a size R to the source. So we've done many times. We're always to do the same thing.
J times R.
So it's a
J.
Well, you can do it even dimensionally, but what times
what?
R. R, yeah. Times J. Because this is per centimeter square, and this is per centimeter cube, so you cancel 1 R. You can understand it this way. What does it mean that the intensity of C comes from the whole volume again, okay, the whole line of sight, sorry. So the intensity is proportional to J. So I know that it was as a power law, the root of t minus 1 divided by 2. And we call it this one, which is alpha, and we call it spectral index. Spectral index. Okay. And it goes, if it's purely optical spin, the frequency, which is max, is just the level of frequency times gamma max square, right? Because it's the frequency at which the maximum electron radiates, and to nu m, where nu m is the level of frequency, gamma min square.
Yeah. Why do you assume that the medium is optically thin?
Because now we do the optical thin. And we always do this, optical thin, optical thin, do it then we put it together.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. What about the medium optical thin? Okay. So when we were doing the trial, it was easy because we said, okay, keep doing it. We know that the source function is the black body. We have the J, we can calculate the absorption coefficient, remember that was straightforward. Okay? But here we have non-thermal electrons. Okay. So how we do it? We use a trick. We assume, so I'm an astrophysicist that always work with non-thermal Yeah, I know that it's not thermal, but we can associate to an electron with energy Me C gamma squared in kinetic temperature. I can equate to the Boltzmann constant times the temperature. This is easy temperature. Okay. And since most of the energy of this electron is emitted at this frequency, so I know that most of the energy is emitted at nu equals lambda frequency gamma squared. I can associate, so gamma, I associate gamma with the temperature, but gamma is associated with the frequency. So I can associate on each frequency the temperature. So let's say that the temperature is proportional to the frequency to the 1/2. Okay, and then I know something else. If this was a quantum, so what does it mean? That each electron has its own temperature and they emit at a given frequency. Okay, they're always using the same kind of thinking. Okay, and but then I know that if the temperature was constant, the emission would be their body. Okay, so and to make things easy, when h nu less than kT, we have the Radiative approximation. Okay? So I know that the intensity is 2 kT. This temperature, nu squared, c squared. So an electron with this temperature, if it's optically heated, which means that it absorbs, self absorbs, only emits, sorry, this frequency, but also while irradiates, it self-absorbs mainly this frequency. Its intensity is this one. So if all the electrons had the same temperature, then the intensity goes as a black body. But we know that each electron has its own gamma, and they absorb preferentially at a certain frequency. So I put this in here, and I know that the intensity goes as nu to the pi half. Okay, so this is very, very important. So, okay. So let's say that there is a frequency here below which the electrons self-absorb their radiation. So the, we want to say the emission doppler stick. So the spectrum, which is very important, this is actually the spectrum that in HEN, for synchrotron emission, we observe. So it goes as powerful in the optical, it's nu to the minus alpha in the optical energy, and nu to the phi alpha in the opticalistic regime. And this is the absorption frequency. This is the star comes from different electrons with different gamma, so it goes as new to the 5 half. This is what is observed in HEN generally. This is when the absorption frequency is larger than the frequency at which gamma min emits. We are going to see in a second that for gamma reverse,
the jet,
and X-rays is more penetrating, and you see from the older jet. we say the emitting region.
And another question is, all this stuff was discovered by observations or people knew in advance?
No, these are all theory.
All theory?
Then,
but this theory was developed in order to explain observations, or they discovered afterwards that?
Okay, so I think that all these are not sure, but I would say that all this radiation is not being invented by astronomers, because radiation in magnetic field is something that physics knew very well. So I think we just borrowed things and applied to astrophysical sources. I'm not sure. And we modified it. We, for instance, we took a power law distribution because we observed power law spectrum. So and then. On the other hand, all the atomic physics knew very well how you accelerate shocks, for instance, electron, and they knew that you have power distribution of electrons. So we said, so maybe in jet there are shocks. So I think we borrowed.
What is the frequency of observe with the instrument today. More or less.
So this is if you basically integrate for the whole sky. The whole sky is 1 or 2 per day. This is good for
the
integrated. Yes. Yes, integrated for the whole sky. And okay, so and there's no burst with very different shapes, but they all last between a fraction of a second to tens of seconds, even up now up, I understand 2 minutes, some strange bursts. Okay, but all we saw was in gamma rays, or from gamma rays. And for 30 years, we didn't know anything about them. So there were a lot of speculation. There were over 100 different theories about these bursts. So we didn't know anything. Why? Because with gamma rays, you have very poor resolution, angular resolution of the sky. So they couldn't go and look with optical telescope. You could find like huge patch of sky, a lot of objects, and they didn't know the counterpart. And there was a basic question that was going on all the time in the community, which is, are gamma rays versus galactic? So they come from the galaxy or extragalactic? And so they made a very famous debate between Bogdan Paczynski, for instance, and Noam Lamb. And the moderator was my supervisor, actually, at the time. I was doing astronomy, but later became my supervisor, Martin Wilson. And famously, Noam Lamb were supporting the idea that gamma ray bursts were coming from neutron stars, galactic neutron stars. While Paczynski was saying, no, they are extragalactic because of energetic. On energetic grounds, and also because he was always a pioneer person, he's very, well, he was like, unfortunately, but it was always someone looking much ahead of anyone else, I would say. And he was saying, okay, probably comes from merger of neutron stars, neutron star merging. Okay, so this was a debate, and soon after, I think that the same year or the year after, came a very famous result. But to understand it.
What is called Dan Dewey? His name? Dan Dewey debate. The name of the debate.
Yes, it's called the Dan Dewey debate. Yes, because for that the year of Dan Dewey.
Yes,
I think so.
Is it a place?
No, it's like the English Queen has the Jubilee.
Ah, it's some kind of.
It's a feast.
Feast. Okay.
No. I can exactly tell you what is it, but I would suppose that it was coming from the Jubilee of the king or the king. But I can check maybe a place now that you think. Okay. Okay. So I need to explain something to you to understand the result. It's very simple, you know. Okay. So this is the galaxy here, the sun. This is the galaxy. Okay, if the source would be in the galaxy, what would be the distribution? If there were neutron stars in the galaxy, gamma rays would come from neutron stars in the galaxy. If I make a map of the sky, where most of the sources are?
In the
In
the patch of the strip of the galaxy.
Yes, in the disk, exactly. So I would say the strip, exactly. So. I would see something like this. This is our distribution of galactic sources in galactic coordinates. If instead the sources were isotropic, I would see a distribution like this all over the place and nothing on the galaxy. Okay? So in 1991, the VATSE instrument was launched exactly to map gamma ray burst and their distribution. They say, okay, let's try to solve this problem. And and this was the result. So actually, was that wasn't there, but they told me that was announcement by the group. So we have the result, and the screen was black, and then suddenly this came out, and everybody said, and so Paczynski was right. So gamma ray bursts are extragalactic sources. But the problem that still in 1996, I think this is 1996, 1995, we still didn't know what they were. Okay.
I have a question, but if they are extragalactic, as you told me in the previous slide, it should be some sources lacking the galactic plane.
Well, this is, they subtracted the galaxy already.
Ah, okay.
So they are the one that you see on the other side of the today. This is, it's a, there are none from the galaxy. So now we know for sure. So they subtracted the galaxy. So, but again, the precision was so large, the localization precision was so bad, that we couldn't point towards the source after we saw the seconds of gamma rays and they were gone. Okay, so what the community decided to be a satellite, like a very fast satellite. So, actually, it's an Italian Dutch satellite called Beppo Sats. Beppo was Giuseppe Chiarini, was a famous physicist in Milan, and they named the satellite after him. And it was actually constructed, it was a risk actually, because we didn't know anything about gamma ray bursts at the time. But they took a risk and they said, okay, we want absolutely to find an X-ray counterpart. Because with X-ray, we have a much better spatial resolution and we can turn optical telescope from ground and finally see where they are, what they are, and so on. But, okay, this was the risk, right? Because there were theories that were they were predicting that those sources would emit X-rays, but they were only theory. They say, okay, let's suppose that the jet is produced in this way, then you should see X-rays, but pure theory. So they launched in 1997. So they launched, so Beppo Sats a couple of years before, and in February 1997, finally, so it was constructed this way. He had a very large gamma ray detector. He would see a gamma ray burst, and then it would be turned very rapidly towards the gamma ray burst, and finally, X-ray was detected. And after like one day, nothing. Okay. So finally, we have the counterpart. I think it was the optical telescope, the Herschel optical telescope was turned. And okay, so this is the latent step, is another burst. But at the time, was the Herschel satellite was pointed, and they saw the optical counterpart. And then the optical counterpart disappeared after a week or so, and the host galaxy appeared. So finally, with optical, we could get the redshift, because only we use optical lines in general. And we finally was proved that they are extragalactic. Actually, the mean redshift now, I think, is still around 2. So they're really, and they have the record, I think it's 8, redshift 8, the most distant gamma ray burst. Okay, so now, so all this excitement.
I'm sorry. What is the difference, or are the same between counterparts and afterglow?
Okay. So, So one counterpart is the observers use the word counterpart every time there is the same object measured in a different band, and afterglow is something that the theoretician use, and I'm going to explain what it is. The afterglow. But it's the afterglow that produces optical and X-rays. But it's the theoretical concept. Okay. But what actually produced gamma ray burst? Okay, finally, this year, I was just started doing astronomy. So finally, I was in the middle of something good, because all the excitement was before me, you know. So but I arrived, and still we didn't know what produced gamma ray burst. But in 2003, finally, we saw a supernova exploding at the same time as a gamma ray burst. And so So finally, we understood that this long gamma ray burst comes from massive stars that explode, supernova, and launch jets at the same time. And this is the model, which is, nobody was believing this was predicted. So that this is the star that is going to be destroyed. The jet is carving its way out, is going up, and then the rest of the star explodes. Okay? And what we see here is a gamma ray burst. Gamma ray burst is a jet from a massive star that explodes. And why we're doing this? Because the emission is in synchrotron emission. So these jets are magnetized, and they have relativistic non-thermal electrons. So all these X-ray and optical and gamma rays are showing you is all synchrotron emission. Okay. But exactly how is emitted? Okay, so the last two slides. So we know that for long gamma ray bursts are bursts that last more than a few seconds. The one that lasts like 10 hundreds of seconds. We have a black hole, we think, that in this explosion, we think this is all field. That is, in this explosion, a core collapse, you form a black hole, you accrete some of the star, and you launch this jet, and the star explodes. Okay, so the core collapse creates a black hole, accretion and jets. So then the jet comes out of the star, we saw it, and in the first part, we think that you have what is called internal shocks. These jets are homogeneous and fluid collide with itself. Okay. So this manual jets collide with itself, and each collision creates a burst. That's what we see in gamma rays. Remember, it was very spiky. But then afterwards, the jet becomes homogeneous and it collides with the external medium. And what we see in the light curve, I can show you, is a power flow in time. What we think is that the jet is sweeping up material and decelerating. So it's switching off until it goes at rest. That's why the emission is first in X-rays, but then in optical and in radio, so at lower, lower frequency, because it's decelerating and switching off. And,
From which time we start to see the gamma rays?
When it becomes optically thin, because before it's extremely optically thick, because we are talking about sizes that are very small, 10 to the 9 to the 10 centimeter, because it's the very core of the star. And so when it becomes optically thin, at least at some frequencies, we start seeing emission. A gamma rays becomes optically thin, and we see this emission. This one lasts a few tens of seconds. This one can last years. Okay. We see radio after 1 year from the explosion now. And what is the same from here? Well, this one. Okay. And now you know very well. Okay. So this one at a few 10^9. Almost 10 to the 10 is the absorption frequency, below which the flux is optically thick. And so we have this power law. Okay. Then the plasma becomes optically thin, and we have this nu to the 1/3. Why is that? So because its emission, okay, so maybe this is not something that many understand. Not many astronomers know. You will know. So these electrons, we know that they have a spectrum that does like this. Okay? This is nu to the 1/3. The total spectrum is the convolution of spectrum given by single electrons, but they are less and less with higher gamma. That's why you have power law. Why you have a power, okay? But this part before a gamma ray burst, before becoming optically thick, you see the tail of the spectrum of the single electron. Okay.
And if you have the part where they are looking at the peak, which is the, you know, the temperature. You
want. Of the single electron spectrum. one is the exponential decay, but there are many with gamma min and much less with gamma max. So I just summing up. Okay. So if I see a gamma reversed, and I know this is new to the 1/3. Okay. Okay, so this is new to the 1/3. So the next part for synchrotron emission, but must be new to the minus p minus 2 divided by 2. Must be that. Then I go, I make a fit, and I measure that is 0.75. So I know how much the value of p. So I divide that p is 2.5. And this is important for theory of acceleration of electrons.
So what? This is just for from nu n and to nu c.
Nu c. Okay, what is nu c? I'm going to say. And this is the data set by root. Okay, so far, this is the last thing that we do. Now we will have the exercise to understand a very important thing, which is emission at high frequencies. And this is a feature that is in gamma reversed, in HN, and so on. So far, we have assumed that this distribution doesn't change in time. What does it mean? That is that the pool in time, the energy divided by the power, the time it takes to pool, is much longer than the age of the source. So what we see is the original distribution. And it gives this power load. Okay? But gamma reversed is a jet that is becoming old and old. Its life becomes older and longer and longer. And very energetic electrons, deep cooling, how this evolved. This is a very important result that allows us to equal emission. So to solve this problem, we use the continuity equation for the energy. Okay. So this is the last thing to keep your attention to. Just really the last 5 minutes. Okay. So what we can use it in general is the continuity equation to understand how distribution of electrons or particle energy changes with time. So the continuity equation says that the distribution of particles time changes because it's changing its gamma with time.
Part with injection. That's what it's saying. Associazione di professori dell'Università di Perugia. Professores, recuerden que en la Universidad tenemos fondo de bienestar universitario y fondo de desarrollo de vivienda, en los cuales el profesorado tiene participación con mucho voto para definir las políticas y sus reglamentaciones. Le invitamos durante 22 horas a participar en este espacio de
educación.
Which is very easy because it's just minus p times. half. So since P is 2.5, nu is 1.25. So that actually was wow, we are really seeing a synchrotron spectrum with the same P. I mean, all the theory and the observation matched. That was quite a result, you know, because it's nice to derive things here. But nature is saying that we are right.
So the books falls rapidly because electrons with higher energy start to occult them very fast.
Yes.
This is why it is very important.
Yes. Because we can no longer ignore the relative losses for very energetic electrons. And so you have a break in the spectrum.
This is the most complete cool spectrum of our
life. This is one of the most complete after the low spectrum that we know. Okay, thank you.
A las dos tenemos seminario.